Good afternoon. It is the first day of winter, and in case you haven't been outside yet, it has arrived with a bang. The entire state shivering as a powerful cold front takes hold. It's causing a few dramas at Sydney Airport. There have been some hairy moments as planes battle 85 kilometre an hour winds. Ferries have been cancelled at Watson's Bay as the winds whip up large swell. The gusts also bringing down trees in numerous suburbs, this one falling on a vehicle at President's Avenue at Gomea. And power lines are struggling to stand up in the onslaught, many falling and in need of repair. Ausgrid is working to restore power to those affected as soon as possible. But the cold snap has been great news for our snowfields, which have been blanketed amid solid dumping. So much so, the season will start earlier at Perisher. Let's go live to James Wilson, who's there for us this afternoon. James, the early snowfall got plenty of people excited.
Yeah, Davina, I can confirm it's still cold and it's still snowing at the moment. Although this is man-made snow, Perisher have been pumping their snow guns today in preparation for this Saturday. The dumpings here have been so good. They've moved their season forward by a week and the vibe around here is palpable. Everybody is so stoked, particularly given the last two seasons we've had, Davina. COVID has pretty much wiped out their revenue stream. Around 80% of visitors to the slopes and the snowy mountains come from Sydney. So given these two massive lockdowns we've had, well, it's been pretty tough times here indeed. But we are back. The groomer has been out perfectly manicuring the front valley behind me. I even had a go on the skis a little bit earlier and had a great time. But one person who's more excited than any is the resort manager Belinda. This is what she had to say.
It's wonderful. Like, I think for our whole community here in the Snowy Mountains region to be able to get open and get going after the last couple of years is just super exciting. And, you know, when we've got snow on the ground and Mother Nature's doing her bit, it makes it a whole lot easier for us.
Davina, Threadbow will still open on the 11th of June. That is next Saturday. There's still plenty of fresh powder down there. But if you want to get a booking, you better get in quick because the phones are running hot. Davina?
That is good news for them, James. Thank you. Well, joining us now is Amber. Amber, the first day of winter, it certainly felt like it. What were the temperatures like?
Good afternoon, Davina. Well, it was bitterly cold. These morning skies are looking pretty in Penrith, but not giving away how cold it actually felt. Now, it was all because of strong to gale force westerly winds. We saw gusts of 95 kilometres an hour hit Kurnell and more than 80 kilometres an hour at the airport, Camden and Harbour. It's very, very gusty indeed. Now, the coldest part of the day, the wind chill made it feel like minus one at the airport. We may as well have been at the snow. Zero in Camden, 1 degree in the city and 4 degrees in Bankstown and Campbelltown. Now, that is in stark contrast to these official temperatures that were closer to 13 to 15 degrees, but it certainly didn't feel like it. Now, if you were cold in Sydney, you wouldn't want to be at Top Station in Threadbow today. It recorded an apparent temperature of minus 27 at around 8 a.m. Now, a severe weather warning remains in place for damaging winds across much of eastern New South Wales, but conditions are expected to ease this evening, although there'll still be a strong wind warning along the coast tomorrow from Port Macquarie all the way down to Eden. I'll tell you what's in store temperature-wise tomorrow a little later in the bulletin, Davina.
OK, thanks, Amber. Well, the new Labor government has been given a clearer picture of the economy it's inherited as growth figures for the first quarter of the year are released. Let's bring in our federal politics reporter Jonathan Thursley in Canberra. John, good afternoon. What are the numbers?
Davina, the economy grew 0.8% in the 3 months to the end of March, 3.3% over the year. Household spending has risen, but more people are more frequently digging into the cash they've been saving. And even though COVID hit mining production over the course of the year, the amount the sector helps the economy actually grew because of soaring prices for commodities. Domestically, there's been soaring prices in the energy market too. One of the issues Labor said it would address if it won the election is rising power prices, a key cost of living pressure as Australians dive into a chilly winter from today. There's also the likelihood in the months ahead of interest rates rising and problems with inflation, but the Treasurer still insists the government will push for minimum wages to rise above inflation. Here's some of what he had to say.
The situation that we've inherited is serious. In some instances, it is dire, and we can only deal with these economic challenges if we work together. State, federal, local government, business, employers, employees, everybody working together to see if we can make some progress.
This afternoon, Prime Minister Anthony Albanese brought together his cabinet and full ministry looking ahead to an October budget, but how it can deal with both the ballooning debt and ease the rising cost of living at the same time. Here's some of what he had to say.
Cherish every day, make a difference every day. in this room. We have been given a great responsibility. If we get it right, we can be here in the long term and really change the country for the better. Better future wasn't a slogan, it was a plan.
So the Prime Minister has big dreams and a big vision. His cabinet was made official after a swearing-in ceremony at Government House this morning. There were some notable moves. Jason Clare takes the reins at Education. Tanya Plibersek, you can see there, has been moved into Environment and Water, while Claire O'Neill takes the Home Affairs portfolio. Some extra significance too. This cabinet has 10 women. That is more than any other cabinet in Australian political history at a federal level. And with Anthony Albanese wanting his ministry to be diverse, there are two Muslim ministers, Ed Husic and Anne Ali. Also, this touching moment this morning after Linda Burney became Australia's first female Indigenous cabinet minister. She embraced the Governor-General. So now, Davina, with all of that done, the Prime Minister has his team on the field, knowing he has to be ready for this very big game ahead.
OK, Jono, thank you. Well, the voice of rugby league is hanging up his microphone. Ray Warren stepping down from commentating after an incredible year spanning more than five decades. Nine's James Bracey joins us in the studio. James, it's not exactly a shock, but still a huge day for rugby league and for Nine.
It certainly is, Davina, an emotional one for rugby league fans, for everyone that works here at Nine and in the wide world of sports as well. Ray Warren, 55-year commentary career, started here at Nine, though, in 1988. And from then on, well, the rest is history. The voice of rugby league, the soundtrack to the sport, and some combinations, some great ones too, with the likes of Phil Gould, Peter Sterling, Paul Vorton, just to name a few. We'll be hearing from a few of them tonight on Nine News as well from 6 p.m. And their reflections on what is a great career. He called all the big moments. You speak to any player in the modern game, and they say it's a privilege to have him calling every moment of it. And a couple of them are now in the commentary box. I've had the privilege of working with Rabs, including Brad Fittler and Billy Slater, now coaches of the Origin teams. And what an absolute treat it was. Speaking to Ray today on the phone, very emotional.
Yeah,
he was fighting back tears. And this is, he said walking away from the grand final last year between the Rabbitohs and Panthers, he was really happy with his performance then, but he knew. He knew then. And 6 months on, you can tell how hard it was for him to actually make the decision that it was time to hang up the microphone.
Yeah, it's a tough call when you love something so much. I know as a Queenslander growing up, no one calls out Queenslander better than Rabs. Everyone's got a favourite call. And talk us through some of the highlights and the iconic moments.
Yeah, look, from a club level, grand final moments, whether it's Cronulla breaking the drought, and then, of course, Jonathan Thurston and that field goal, but Origin, there are so many. This, though, particularly for those north of the border, one to remember.
Beats one, gets it in field. Hancock gets it on. Queenslander coming back. Darren Smith for Lager. Lager gets it away. Here's the big fella. Gets the pass on. Coyne goes for the corner and gets the try. Queensland, it's a miracle.
Oh, yeah. What about that one? It's Dolo.
Unbelievable. What about that from Queensland? I can't believe it. Unbridled joy on the sideline, and why not?
That's not a try, that's a miracle. Queensland are in front now.
You said it, Raz. What a combination, too. Just shy of the 100 Origin games, but that makes it a little more special as well. So well done, Rabs. We salute him today, an absolute champion.
We love him. Well said, James. Thank you.